What's up, Cardboard Nation? Welcome to another episode of GoGTS Live, the Hobby's web show. We're glad you joined us this evening. I'm your host, Rob Bertrand. Joining me, as always, that guy over there, Ivan Lovgren. Ivan, how are you?
I'm doing fantastic today, Rob. It's a beautiful day in this neighborhood. I am surrounded by cards. My personal office has just exploded in the last couple of months, much like the hobby. So I'm happy to be on and talk about some cards tonight.
Awesome. Yeah, well, we've got a great show planned tonight, including a great and lively debated poll question, I'm sure, which we'll circle back to in just a second.
So debated.
We've got a ton of stuff going on in Hobby Happenings. We have a special unboxing segment. I received a package from BCW that we'll dive into later. We've got only two box breaks tonight. Only two, but believe it or not, the current market value on those two boxes is ranging between $1,350 and $1,550. We've got a look at a brand new product from Topps, as well as Hot in the Shop, and a lively interview from Yahoo Finance, which we'll detail a little bit later on. But we kick things off with the GoGTS Live Q of the Week poll, and it's an interesting one. The question is there a solution to retail hoarding? And if there is, what would be the best solution? We came up with three potential options and asked you to weigh in with other if you had something. And currently locked like video games, limits at checkouts, and very restocking days, the three choices. Other with 8.3% and lots of people replying. Locked up like video games is the current number one answer. Mm-hmm. Now, Ivan and I, you and I were talking before the show started, and we're, you know, discussing, well, number one, is it a problem? Number two, can it actually be solved? And then three, if so, how? And so you brought up an interesting point that right now with, you know, 10% unemployment, people are finding ways to make money. This is one of them. Good point. Now, I'm going to sound like anything but the fiscal conservative that I am, but I'm quite tired of, I long for the good old days when my wife asked me to run out and pick up milk, bread, duct tape, and chlorine for the pool. And then I could, you know, hit Target or Walmart and, you know, hit the card aisle and grab something. And those days are just, they're over. It's over. And I kind of miss that. And so while I get the fact that there's money to be made, my concern is that the retail channel is supposed to be a gateway to get people into the hobby, not a channel for a few to hoard everything and drive up prices online. So while I get the making money aspect of it, I think there's something just inequitable about the whole situation right now to me.
So, yeah, you know, so the problem is the inequity that's in retail products in general, I feel, that creates that incredible chase. Because, again, they hit the shelf. The minute they hit the shelf, it's almost like they're discounted versus the way the configuration is set up. If there's a chance to make money and you have the ability to, you know, why are you not going to? Some people work jobs where they make more money than flippers would doing that. Some people have an ethical aversion to it. But the fact of the matter is, it only takes one, two people knowing a Target rep's route in or an Excel rep or MJ Holdings or whatever companies those are in a city like Los Angeles to pick up 60 of these boxes that they can sell for three times the profit. So one, I voted for lock and key, and I voted for that regardless of the retail hoarding, but because of the fact that there's still pack searching that does go on. You know, I've seen pictures of open packs sitting at our Targets and Walmarts on Twitter all over the place. So I've thought they should be under lock and key for quite a while. Actually, I have a question. What is it? Is there something in the agreement? Maybe you know, maybe you don't, but what's keeping Target from charging more money? What's keeping Walmart from charging more money for these products? Because we've seen that sometimes they've held back a little and been released by certain manufacturers on their sites for a markup, right?
Those are in the manufacturer to retail distributor agreements, and then the retail distributor agreements to the big box store. There's a couple different levels. Because of the point that I said of what the purpose of those products was originally intended for. And so Target isn't then allowed to go check eBay, look at the pricing, put the rest of their stock out, and mark it up to that. They're just not allowed to do that.
Yeah. Okay. Well, so that's one part of it, but then it comes down to what you said, which is, well, actually, Rob, what did you say about retail in general that sort of spurred the debate that we got into? Your feelings about retail packs. I get tweeted at a lot on Twitter with a lot of people that say to me, they say, "Oh, retail's for suckers." I'm not kidding. You can check my timeline and see the people tweeting.
It may have used to have been, but it certainly isn't anymore.
Yeah, and that's
for the very reason that you said, is that because the configuration is such that it automatically releases at a discount based on the insert ratio of certain cards. But so all that aside, I want a solution to the few getting a lot and the many not getting any. And so I think the only solution is a combination of all of the above. Because if you put limits at checkouts, you're going to have people that grab their girlfriend, their two friends, their cousin, and the cousin's brother, and go in and max out the limits. At least by putting various measures in place, I'd like to just see it be a little bit more difficult for then someone to know the route, pull up on that day and time, pull a card up to the aisle, and just hand, you know, wave everything that's stocked into a cart and check out. That's just, to me, something's got to be done about that.
Kind of funny. I just got the funniest tweet. There was a thread going around with a flipper who's selling flipping advice and bragging about how much he has, and someone is allegedly doxing him as a Walmart regional supervisor.
Well, see, you have that problem too. So,
yeah,
let's look at some of the responses that the audience gave. Mike Hookem, Mike E said, "I don't honestly believe that a solution is needed. Demand is nice and necessary to keep the hobby alive. If anything, maybe some more products that aren't in such big demand, like Panini Football or Topps Big League, to keep collectors with less fun still in the game."
And this is something I've been saying for years. I know how you feel about it, but I feel different. Topps opening day, you can still get it for retail cost. It's not 3X.
If that's my only option, I want option and variety like there used to be.
Okay. Well, so Big League is coming out, what, this week, next week, right?
It's been out.
Heritage has been sitting on shelves for a while before it started disappearing. You know, there is some variety. Also, remember, this is... Now you're asking for two things. You're saying, well, I want collectors to be able to get, I want new people to be introduced to it at retail. And then you're saying, and I want variety. It's like, well, you know, there's a couple of things now. Every time you give them something, they want a little something more.
I don't think it's too much to ask. I can walk into the soup aisle and there's 100 soups. I'd like to walk into the card aisle and have, you know, the 20 choices that existed, you know, even 18 months ago. But let's look at some more answers, because some people have some very good opinions. Mark Ruckersfeld said, who's M.R. Ruckersfeld, "As much as it may suck for lots of people, just take it out of retail locations altogether. Make it only available online and in card shops. Retail selection is shrinking already, so why not pull the plug?" Unfortunately, because there's not a card shop within simple driving distance for the majority of people nowadays, unfortunately.
Seth
Ward 0011 says, "Well, I don't honestly think there is a solution. I chose very restocking days, By now, the vast majority of collectors and flippers know what day and time their stores are restocked. He also mentions that it's probably not going to happen because they have set routes and schedules, obviously.
Yeah. I was going to say in the Twitter comments, or in the Twitch comments, sorry, if you're watching on Twitch, that guy Hugs does respond to what you said with, well, no one is buying soup for 99 cents and selling it for $50.
Not yet.
So they are slightly different.
All we need is one more pandemic, I think, and that could change.
Yeah. And Mike Wiley, who I also know, I think responded on Twitter and in the Twitch. He said something that I also see a lot, and it's this argument, well, my LCS buys them all and then marks them up. You know, it's a double-edged sword, because I know of a couple of LCS employees here in Los Angeles who have told me, we don't buy it. The flippers come and sell it to us. They know, just like many of us have complained about eBay, right? They know the risks of selling online. They also know that we are having trouble getting product. And so, yeah, we'll pay them $50 a blaster and then mark it up to $55 just to get you in the store, just to have product for you. So I'm not saying that's every LCS, but, you know, the reaction of walking into a card shop and seeing a retail blaster and saying, oh, you're terrible, horrible, ruining the hobby, the kids. Like, whoa, let's all just calm down a bit.
Slow your roll, yeah.
Yeah. Because I get tweeted that a lot, too. Well, I went to this LCS and they had blasters and I'm never going there again. And it's like, well, maybe they camp out at the Target and that's why your LCS doesn't open until 10:30. Or maybe it comes in the door and, you know, just like they buy from anybody else. You know, you want them to buy your Blake Bortles autographs when you walk in the door with them. Well, they're also buying the Topps opening day blasters. I don't know.
Mike Estrich, Mibu22, says, simple solution, roll it out more slowly and not put all the stock out at once and not at the same time of the day. Greg, I always screw up your name, Greg, Reemsma. One of the freedoms we enjoy is the right to choose how much we buy and sell, knowing we have to live with the consequences of said choices. There are always reasons for limitations, just no excuses for our choices. Eric Bailey, EJ Bailey 54, says, at this point, get rid of it altogether. Well, Ted Dastic Jr. says the best solution is to just buy hobby. And Rick Custer, Custer 12, says, I think it would have to be locked up like video games and a daily limit combo, varying restocking days. Does it make a difference due to the guys who bribe the reps and honestly start making the card boxes not for resale and enforce that? None of which will happen.
It was so good until the very end.
Ricky Hedrick at Ricky Hedrick 23 says, stop buying hangers and retail boxes on eBay for insane prices. Force them to open the product and make them roll the dice to hit a big card.
But so this gets back to the problem and my solution. I do have a solution, Rob, slightly.
Well, I want to hear, you've kind of said your solution. I'm reading what our viewers think the solution should be. You could join me. It's right in front of you.
Well, no, I know. I was jumping in with the Twitch comments there.
On the Rush Sports, On the Rush Sport 1 says, sell direct, ? We've tried to get direct for over a year now. Granted, we don't stock Walmart or Target. If we get lucky, we get lucky. But definitely gets frustrating for people who care about the hobby and not just a dollar.
Okay, so I do have to jump in because Chris, CLR Shownuff, I'm so happy I'm finally saying his name right. He just dropped a Twitch comment, which is, again, kind of what you said, but just stop buying overpriced retail and prices will go down like gas prices. But here's the real problem. It's not overpriced. The configuration of retail has not changed relative to hobby boxes, but the price of hobby boxes has shot through the roof. So if you've got one silver Prism rookie per blaster of Prism basketball and it's $20 and you're getting four in a hobby box or even six in a hobby box and the hobby box is $260, you can see right there that, yeah, the blaster is worth more money. So I think part of it is going back to what so many people have said about retail 4 or 5 years ago is the manufacturers might need to adjust down the hits in retail, because now that ink and paper assets are such big hits, it is worth that price in the secondary market.
Okay, so we're getting somewhere. Okay, so that is an option. I also think it's time to re-examine the retail pricing structure. Everybody loves being able to spend $20 for a blaster and scratching that itch. But if the reality is that you're going to walk into your big box store and there not be anything there for you to scratch that itch with, would you be willing to pay $40 for a blaster?
And I'll give you an example of this, Rob, that I have, I believe I have right here. Where is it? Oh, it's in my box. So I opened one of the $100 blasters of Panini Court Kings International. And people were saying, oh, $100 blaster, what's the deal with that? You know, like, well, they just had in mind a blaster is $20. And I don't have any of them here because I did sort them out and put them in my Comp C box. But a Luka base card from this is going for $25. A Giannis base card from this is going for $30. A LeBron base is going for $30. So, yeah, that is a solution to charge a little more and watch either the market catch up or the market settle, you know, in line with that. Okay. I mean, a Luka Prism is a $60 card now. A base Prism from this year's second year is $60. So obviously a blaster at $20, if there's a $60 base card, we're not even talking Zion.
It's okay. Yeah. So we've gone from what can be done to a handful of things that can at least be tried. Right. Mm-hmm. And the problem right now is nothing's happening. And it's been that way for a while. Mm-hmm. And so I guess, will we see changes? Or, I mean, the big box store just wants to sell it out. I get it. They don't care if one person buys 100 of them or 100 people buy one of them. I get that. Mm-hmm. So maybe it's time for the manufacturer to either do what you suggested or maybe both. Reconfiguration of the SKU and or raise the pricing.
Yeah. I do like AM Peters 84 put in a nice little, I think, button for this, which is I used to buy retail packs to see if I liked the product enough to buy hobby.
Right.
So the question is, which assets in the retail pack would be enough for you to know that you want to chase the bigger hits in hobby? You know, like that's sort of the balancing point. You know,
yeah, absolutely. Good point. So. All right. Well, if you haven't weighed in on the poll, please do, and we'll update it later in the program. That poll is also important because, Ivan?
Yeah, because we are going to be giving away the hits from those $1,300-plus worth of card boxes we're opening up. And the way you enter to win the hits is you have to be following us and engaging with us on Twitter. So I know that you're watching on live stream, you're watching on YouTube, you're watching on Twitch. But our giveaway system draws winners from Twitter. So if you have not already, this is your first time watching, you just found us out of the blue, sign up for a Twitter account, twitter.com, follow at GoGTSLive, vote in the poll for fun, and then engage with the tweets throughout the night that we'll put out there. That's how you'll enter to win the hits. What are the hits? We don't know, but we've got two incredible boxes to open, Gold Standard from Panini and Chronicles Basketball. So if you're complaining you can't find Chronicles Basketball on retail shelves, well, guess what? You can win some here tonight on Go GTS Live.
That is true. That is true. But before we get into that or even into hobby happenings, we have a couple of bonus giveaways that I wanted to share with you. A couple of months ago, you might remember, did an interview with WWE superstar Mickie James, and she had promised to send out some autographed photos. Well, guess what? Those finally arrived, and Miss James outdid herself. And so two lucky winners will receive a autographed photo of the one and only Mickie James.
And I don't want to make you do too much work, but if you missed that interview, we also have a YouTube channel with past videos, so you can go see that interview on our YouTube channel, Go GTS Live on YouTube.
In addition, we haven't given away any Go GTS Live swag in a little while.
Oh, so, you know why, Rob?
because we aren't at the National.
Yeah. So you got all that National swag to give away.
So two lucky winners tonight are not only going to get a T-shirt, but also a Go GTS Live breaking mat. So four winners, and we haven't even really done anything yet. So that's pretty cool.
That's awesome. So go ahead and retweet the poll question. We're at 208 votes right now. So that'll be the first one. I'm going to draw some winners from the poll question as well. So go to twitter.com/GoGTSLive. It's the pinned tweet right now. Go retweet the poll question, and that's how you will enter to win that bonus giveaway.
Awesome. Very cool. And thanks to Miss James. All right, let's take a look at a plethora, if you will, of news, notes, and nuggets in a segment that we do every week called Hobby Happenings. Well, if you purchased any of this year's Topps Chrome Baseball at hobby or retail, you may be wondering if you've pulled any short prints or variations. Well, Ryan Cracknell at Beckett Media put together a superb guide with all the details you need, including an image gallery of each card. However, here's just a quick reference guide for your convenience. Using the code at the bottom of the card, regular base cards end in 595, variations in 635, and SSP variations in 641. To see the regular and SP and SSP variations of all the cards, visit Beckett.com.
This last week, bidding for the seemingly lone surviving unopened case of 1986-87 Fleer basketball finally closed at Collect Auctions. Sports Collectors Daily reports that in all, 13 different bids were placed for the case, which had a final bid of over $1.49 million. Add to that the standard 20% buyer's premium, and that pushed the realized price of this case of basketball cards, with no autographs, no patches, no silver prisms, to roughly $1.79 million. To break it down a little further, that means that it comes to about $149,000 per box, a whopping $4,143 a pack. Sealed in the original case. The buyer is known to be Thomas Fish, owner of Blowout Cards. However, Fish was allegedly purchasing it on behalf of a client. The new owner's name has not been immediately revealed, but Blowout has indicated to us that the case will remain unopened. So it'll be exciting to see where that pops up next and in what sort of configuration, but it will remain unopened.
Well, the jersey worn by New York Yankees legend Mickey Mantle when he drilled the next-to-last home run of his extraordinary career could bring $1 million or more in Heritage Auctions Summer Platinum Night Sports Collectibles Catalog Auction, which runs August 29th through the 30th. Mantle's bomb into the upper deck of Detroit Tigers Stadium was remarkable for more than the fact that it was his next-to-last round-tripper of his Hall of Fame career. Wearing the offered Mears authenticated jersey, Mantle hit his shot off of Detroit ace Denny McClain, the 24-year-old fireballer who was putting the finishing touches on one of the finest seasons in baseball history. McClain had already won his 30th game of the season, a total not reached in the 52 years since, when he faced Mantle in his last game in the Motor City.
The journey of a card sent to PSA to be authenticated and graded should not be a mysterious one, and when the card in question is your card, a little more crystal clear understanding would probably be seen as a good thing. With that in mind, PSA recently published an article that details the multifaceted 12-step grading process that PSA uses. We highly encourage you to check out the well-written guide for yourself on the PSA blog.
This made me laugh, and it truly may usher in a new segment to the show called Go GTS Live Tweet of the Week. Collector Michael Mendelson, a.k.a. Kid Mikey 1 on Twitter, posted, I found this card in my rented storage place last month in a shoebox and unsleeved. Today I got it back from PSA. Last one sold on eBay for $6,800. To which Sports Collectors Daily cleverly replied, "That'll cover the rent." Yeah, I'll say. Well done.
In some hobby business news, this week, officials at Beckett Media made the difficult decision to reconfigure this year's industry summit from an in-person event to a virtual event. Ted Barker, summit director and co-host, announced the changes after revisiting the scheduled venue and consultation with key sponsors. Quote, "After visiting Las Vegas last week, it became crystal clear that a virtual format is the best way to celebrate our industry's incredible success this year," Barker said. "Safety of our attendees is our foremost priority. We are now refocused on delivering an incredible virtual industry summit October 19th through 21st.
Well, being able to treat trading cards as stock has been a fantasy of many collectors through the years. It has also resulted at several attempts at creating market platforms to facilitate that lofty idea. First, way back in the day, there was the Pit, which was started way back in 2000 and later sold to Topps. And interestingly enough, they're actually still around today. You can check them out at thepit.com. Well, then around 2002 came Naxcom, which primarily tried to be an alternative marketplace to eBay, but also dabbled in the asset trading genre of sports cards. And eventually itself became a website called SportsBuy. Well, now more recently, we've seen StockX and StarStock. Well, now it seems there's about to be yet another newcomer to the table with Card Stock Exchange. It seems the demand for such a platform remains strong amidst those with a collecting as an investment mindset. But can it really work? Darren Revelle ran an interesting poll question this past week saying, out of these three, which do you believe has the most transparent marketplace where the rules are clear and you can make money from insight that turns out to be right? And surprisingly, or maybe not surprisingly, sports gambling was the overwhelming leader. So that said, can a real tangible asset trading market for sports cards one day be part of your actual mutual fund? Only time will tell, but it seems many people are still willing to try.
In a fun hobby highlight, GTS customer Joe Davis, who runs gotbaseballcards.com and J&J's Sports Superstore in Loganville, Georgia, was selected to represent the sports card industry or category, excuse me, in eBay's 25th anniversary celebration. An avid sports card collector and longtime seller, Joe turned his childhood hobby into a flourishing business on eBay. After graduating college, Joe and a friend took a leap of faith and opened a 500-square-foot card shop. A very early adopter of eBay, Davis said, "eBay broadened our horizons as far as where to sell, how to sell, which opened us up to the world which we had never been able to do from our tiny 500-square-foot store. Were it not for eBay in those early years, I doubt we would have made it." So a big congrats to Joe Davis, one of the nicest guys in the business, still in the business. Watch this video.
Oh, I got one of the memorabilia cards. Get the blue felt jersey embedded in the card. I'm Joe with Got Baseball Cards in Loganville, Georgia, and we've been buying and selling on eBay since 1998. As a kid, my mom would incentivize me with packs of cards, and so throughout school was a straight-A student and finished second in my high school class. The only person to beat me out was my girlfriend and now my wife. I always say, if you can't beat them, join them. I remember the day a customer walked in and he said, "Well, I've been reselling on eBay," and I'm like, "What's eBay?" We've developed a lot over the years. We currently have over 600,000 items listed. We do more on eBay than we do in our retail store. We get the emails that say, I've been working on this set for 6 years, and I just got the last 3 cards from you. Now I've finally finished my set. I cherish that because I know what they're going through. I live my dream job. I get to do it every day.
Very cool. Congrats again, Joe. Well, sometimes on the business side of the hobby, mistakes happen. And then sometimes those mistakes turn into a criminal investigation. Well, this is the MVP trophy won by Isaiah Thomas for his performance in the 1984 NBA All-Star Game. It was a featured item in Heritage Auction's current sales event. However, there was a problem. Thomas claims the trophy was stolen from his high school alma mater in June of last year, where it had been on loan. Upon being notified, Heritage Auctions responsibly and immediately pulled the item from the auction and began communications with Thomas and local law enforcement. Chris Ivey, Heritage's director of sports auctions, said Heritage does not sell stolen property, so we take any claims of title seriously. Even though each consigner warrants clear title when material is consigned to auction, we do have issues of title or potential stolen property come up a handful of times per year. And in those instances, we investigate to validate any claims. And if the title is in question, then the lot is removed from auction until the dispute can be settled.
Last week, we told you about the NHLPA's exemptions for rookie eligibility status in 2020-21. It's going to be a fun year to talk about next year. 2020-21, Upper Deck NHL hockey products. The full list of eligible players for rookie status is now available for viewing on GoGTS.net.
In previous episodes, we've informed you of the company Rally Road that specializes in offering fractional shares in ultra-rare assets. Well, recently rebranded to just Rally, Sports Collectors Daily is reporting that the company has partnered with Topps to procure 12 limited edition 2020 baseball factory sets, 10 of which will be sold via shares offered on the Rally platform. The other 2 sets will be held by Topps. Each card in the set will be stamped in foil with first edition. The sets will be available beginning at noon Eastern time tomorrow. 10,000 shares of the sets will be offered, priced at $10 each. Like all fractional share offerings, the hope is that interest in the card sets will increase over time, and investors will be able to sell their shares in the sets for a profit down the road. Later in the program, we'll watch an interview that Rally co-founder Rob Petrozzo gave to Yahoo Finance.
What's this, Rob? A Babe Ruth signing? Well, not quite. However, this 1934 Babe Ruth signed Yankees contract offers something that almost no other Ruth artifact can claim: actual period video documentation.
Wow.
Wow. Look at that. So the signing was captured on film on January 15th, 1934, with the camera focusing upon the signature of the early Yankee icon. The signatures of Hall of Fame owner Jacob Ruppert and Hall of Fame slugger Babe Ruth are a perfect match in the video footage and the presented document. The lofty tally of $35,000 was the highest salary in the entirety of Major League Baseball at the time, but still a bargain, as it equates to just about $681,000 adjusted for inflation in today's dollars. My question is, how much more is the contract worth today than the actual assets that it was dictating at the time? Hopefully we'll find out soon.
Interesting. Well, officials at the Pro Football Hall of Fame and Panini America announced a 5-year extension to their long-standing partnership. The deal makes Panini the exclusive distributor of trading cards featuring players, coaches, and contributors elected as members to the Hall's enshrinement classes of 2020 through 2024. Under terms of the agreement, Panini will work with the Pro Football Hall of Fame around a number of key Hall of Fame centennial initiatives. In addition to the partnership, Panini will create a dedicated Hall of Fame logo card wall display inside the museum. I can't wait to see that. This unique exhibit will not only showcase trading cards, but provide an opportunity for fans to engage and share the special social media moments from their visit to the hall. Congratulations on a great marketing partnership, guys, and I can't wait for my next visit to the hall, which is just 20 minutes away.
I love it. To no one's surprise, but still very sad, organizers for the National Sports Collectors Convention 2020 announced that they have officially canceled this year's event, which was originally rescheduled to December 12th through the 16th. Next year's show is currently scheduled to take place next summer in Chicago. Fingers crossed. Want to see all you guys there.
Absolutely. But we're going to leave you on some good news. Good news for collectors. No, I'm really serious, because your trading card supply woes are about to get some major relief. Longtime gaming card supplier Dragon Shield and Beckett Media have partnered to form Beckett Shield, who will be releasing a first wave of between 13 and 15 desperately needed products to the market beginning in the fourth quarter. The first wave of products includes top loaders in five sizes ranging from 35-point to 130-point, as well as 35-point magnetics called card armor and semi-rigids for grading submission, all of which are extremely difficult to find right now, as you know. In addition, the company will be releasing penny sleeves for standard and thick cards, as well as team bags, graded card bags, and nine pocket pages. However, perhaps the best news is that these supplies will be made in North America and distributed from Dallas, Texas, which should greatly ease current supply chain issues. Also, we'll be having an interview with a company representative on next week's show. And that's a look at this week's hobby happenings. How about that, Ivan? You're going to be able to get 35.1 touches called Card Armor. I like the name. Well, very interesting story.
If you can make it happen, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So, anything you want to unpack before we dive into an unboxing segment?
Well, it's another thing I've seen with collectors on Twitter a lot lately. So I love the Kid Mikey story about finding in his storage locker, going back and finding a Giannis rookie card, being able to get it graded and it grading a 10. I know I've also seen a lot of hate from collectors recently about people making up stories like that for attention. And one, I personally know Mikey. Actually, we've met him multiple times at the National. Really, really great guy. But the kind of guy that does spend a bit more in the hobby than I'd say the average collector. So, no, it doesn't actually surprise me, especially because I personally had a second-year Giannis that was in a box that I forgot about until about 4 months ago. I was going through some stuff, and I remembered, hey, I bought two packs of Prism that year. And it wasn't the rookie card, it was the second year, but that's a $100 card. Like, who really remembers some of these guys when they were not a big name, you know?
Oh, I know. I think of all the cards that we packed up as just base insert and parallels that either we gave away in prize packs at the National or donated to charity. And I'm like, I wonder if we've got to rethink that a little bit.
Yeah.
But, all right, so...
So that one was cool. And then I'm also, it has nothing to do with the actual story of Rally Road. But I find it really funny. This happens frequently where a company comes out with a name. Remember, they were originally for cars,
yep,
old cars. So Rally Road really fit. But then you also have to wonder how big and how much value did they have to get before they could buy. I'm sure someone somewhere has Rally trademarked. And so they probably actually had to like enter negotiations for years in order to be able to call themselves Rally versus, you know,
exactly
Rally hamburgers or something like that. So, but yeah, so there you go.
I really liked your story on Babe Ruth, too. I mean, how true is that? You know, the documented video evidence. I mean, you want to talk about provenance? Boom, there it is, smacked all over YouTube. Hey, well, listen, last week on the blog, we put out a post about a new product coming from BCW. It's a modular sorting system, and we're going to take a look at it tonight and give some away.
Yeah, for a minute there, the chat started blowing up because people thought it was supplies, like we were just talking about the shortage. But no, it's the sorting trays that we're going to talk about and demonstrate. But yeah.
So, all right. All right. So bear with me just a little bit here. Enclosed is BCW's new modular sorting tray and some other promo items. Please consider a review on GoGTS Live. If you run a giveaway, let me know. I'm hoping you want to keep this simple and give away a different case. Interesting. So maybe I'll circle back with them on that. Take a look at what's in here. We've got, I'm stocked up on card thickness gauges for a while. One of these will go out with every prize we send out in the near future until that box is empty.
Very cool feature. I love those.
Let's see. Oh, well, geez, thank you so much. Just random. How about a Walker Buehler clearly authentic Topps card? Thanks, BCW.
Very cool. Autographed. I think you left off autographed rookie card.
Autographed rookie card, so we'll give that away.
In fact, here's the thing with clearly authentic, you got to check. What does the sticker say on it?
The sticker.
Yeah, see the sticker at the top that says clearly authentic?
Does
the sticker say?
Oh, 2018.
Yeah, so that's the thing, because, you know, clearly authentic can sometimes be post that. But, yeah, no, that's a true rookie, Walker Buehler.
Nice. Check these out. Keychain cutters. BCW-branded keychain cutters. So everybody who wins a hit tonight will get one of those as well. Wow. Okay, now.
Well, that's a full box of them. Now, wait, are we giving away the Walker Buehler? Because I just did a quick Google. That's a $120 card that they sent you.
Yeah, what are they doing?
What are they doing? Okay.
All right, so we have a case. Six each, eight per pack. So four on top, four on bottom, and each comes with six trays. So they say it's modular, and I'm going to show you why. This is pretty cool. Okay, so pull that out, they come stacked like this. Okay. Now, let's see if I can quickly and easily figure out how to fit these together. Ah, here we go. Yes, they slide like such. Very easy. So, okay, we just go like this. Okay, and so then you put another one there. Whoops, I don't want to bang that too hard, apparently. So let's slide that back in there like this.
So real quick, also make sure you go to twitter.com/GoGTSLive and retweet the BCW tweet in order to enter to win that Walker Buehler. I'm not sure, Rob, are you keeping the sorting trays for yourself?
No, we're going to give some away. I'll tell you. I'll give you details in a minute.
Cool. So, yeah, so stay watching because you can also win the sorting trays. Ish.
We'll All right. So if I want more than six, let's say I want to go 6x2.
Next week's show, we're going to build Legos.
Right?
I joke, but that actually is really cool, being able to construct it yourself. I've got a couple of the previous sorting trays, and it's like, well, depending on what you're sorting, it can be a bit of a hassle. If you're sorting a 45-card set and you've got two 18-count trays, you're like, ah. But then if you've got three 18-count trays and you're like, but I only need 32 team slots, I don't know, it's just... be cool to have this flexibility option.
Plus, in addition, so this lays flat, or can be put at an angle. So say you're done sorting, it can also double as display at a card show, like this.
Nice.
Okay.
Cardball did point out, Rob, you break it, you keep it, so...
Or
be careful with these.
You can do it like this. So they can lay in the tray three different ways, which is pretty fancy.
We also have a question from D-Pan. While you have it there in your hand, when you add weight to them, like cards, how sturdy are they?
Well, on a flat surface, which you can't see. In fact, hold on one second.
Well, I was partially like, are they sturdy build material or are they like plastic?
Oh, yeah,
they're
certainly sturdy build material. In fact, James, if you want to go now to the box break camera. Okay. Oh, good. Okay. So I've got the system here. So those just snap into place like that. On a flat surface, it's much better than me holding it in the air and juggling, and it's extremely sturdy. Very interesting. I love some of the R&D that must have gone into this. Go. So that's 2x6, and then so two more, and then you've got, you know, 12, 18, what, 24 rows. So like, let's say you're doing a base set of 100. Mm-hmm. You know, you only need a 5x5 or whatever. But what I think is ingenious is not just the tray itself, but how I think the different way that these things configure is really cool. Because those displays for card shows are expensive. What if you're just, you know, a weekender guy?
Rob, while we're demonstrating this, so D-Pan actually clarified his sturdiness comment. More so, my worry is picking up the tray and them separating. I've seen you like sliding them in. Does that mean that like if you picked up the whole tray, there's really no risk or fear to you of them it falling apart? I can't really tell though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Once they're together, they're together. You just have to make sure that each one slid in individually.
There you go. You saw it. You saw it live. Trust me, we're not that good with special effects.
They also, let's see.
Hey, quick shout out to Justin.
Top loaders.
Justin just subscribed for his 20th month on Twitch. Thank you, Justin, for your Twitch subscription.
Snap tights. And
yeah, that's the thing that I notice is they look a little wider than the sorting trays that I have that are really just for the card, maybe the card in a sleeve.
And even one touches. So you can use any sort of storage system you have going on for your individual cards if you wanted to set them up for some sort of display after whatever. So let's see. So yeah, this angled feature, it doesn't just sit on the back. It actually snaps in with this little tongue and groove thing here. So that keeps it like that.
Do you know about the configuration?
Yeah.
How many? Yeah.
There's six pieces in one box. And then the case has eight of these. So enough for, you would want four for a 6x4 system. So there'd be two complete 6x4 systems in your case.
Gotcha. Yeah, but so Scotty Ballgame was asking about how would you get 30 for sorting all 30 baseball teams.
So yeah, you then just you get go 6x5, yeah.
Five boxes from your card store or wherever it is that you get your supplies.
So there's four. All right, so I'm going to give away... two winners will each get two boxes. How's that sound?
That sounds good to me. So two boxes. So remind me then, so that's 12. So that's a 6x6 system that you're getting with two boxes, right?
No, let's see. I don't know, just two boxes. Just say boxes.
Oh, I know. I'm just curious. Like, people are talking about the configuration.
Yeah, they're
the
getting
chat,
they're so getting 12. Like, they're getting a 2x6 or a 6x2 or a 3x4 or whatever. 12.
Trying to make sure if they aren't near an LCS and they have to go to other channels that they know what they would need to get. That's all. Gotcha. So cool.
I like it. Very cool. Thank you, Ted and Ken at BCW.
Our good friend Glenn, who watches, who I believe is a teacher, says, don't do math in August. There's no math in August. That's fair. But also, yeah, thank you, BCW, for letting us do some math. Pretty cool system there. I like that it, someone else said it too, but I like that it can break down for storage, especially if you live in a space like I do, or if you're office looks anything like Rob's does, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So,
because I have some of those sorting trays, like I said, and the problem is, it's like I have to lean them up against the wall. Like, yeah, do you really want to see? It's a nightmare behind this curtain. My wife wishes they broke down better. Let's just put it that way. Instead of these plastic things just slanted between a shelf. So very cool. So remember, the tweet is already out there on twitter.com/goGTSLive. Just retweet it and make sure that you are following us to enter to win not only the modular sorting tray boxes, but also the Walker Buehler rookie card auto that they just threw in. Pretty freaking sweet. I love that. Thank you, BCW, for letting us do the unboxing of that.
So there it is, back in the box. Those three, these three.
So we're just about to get ready with our exciting box breaks in a little bit, in just a moment.
Yeah, I got to clean up here.
Yep. So you don't want to go anywhere while we clean up. Do you need more than 10 more seconds? Because I was going to say we could swing into the poll update if you wanted.
Nope, the second box is packed up.
All right, ready to go. Awesome.
I just want to make it look nice and put it back the way it was when I opened it.
So, Rob, there's kind of a funny thing happened just in the middle of this show. I don't know why every single Thursday night I get a notification from ComC that like 7 new cards have been added. It always happens in the middle of the show. So during the quick video we showed earlier, I jumped over and I just looked at it. And, you know, collectors, we love to complain about wait times. We love to complain. I love to complain. I'm just going to take ownership. I complain. I try to be positive, but I like complaining. So I had done the submission back in March, if you remember, before March 6th. And complain. It's not done yet. Well, they just uploaded it, and I had 2 cards that were $4 cards back then. Fernando Tatis Jr. Topps rookie cards that are now $40 cards. Simply because of how much they delayed. Because I guarantee you I would have listed them at $4.74 and sold them without taking advantage of that giant rise. So I guess a little shout out to ComC. Thank you for delaying my cards getting on there. Now we just need Yusei Kikuchi to have a lights out 60 games.
All right. I'm set. Thank you for that, for being patient. But I hope you guys liked the look of that. And so ask for it at your LCS. And here's that Walker Buehler rookie autograph card, courtesy of BCW. Be sure to give them a nice shout out on Twitter.
Yep. Thank them for sending the card. Thank them for sending the sorting trays, and follow them too to see more action on new products that, you know, innovate the hobby from a collecting standpoint. We got new sleeves coming. We got new sorting trays. We've got rubber bands. That's what I need, Rob. Who's going to bring back rubber bands? It's so hard to get top loaders right now. Let's just go back to rubber bands.
All right. Next up from Panini America, 2020 NFL Gold Standard Football. 7 cards in here. One pack. There it is. Nice little brick.
So we ripped some of this last week, had a lot of fun with it. Looking for 5 autos or memorabilia.
I got to fix my box break camera after moving it for that thing.
Whoa. It's like a 3D movie in here.
Yeah, sorry about that.
Oh.
I should have taken the time to set up 3 cameras, but Tre'Davious White. Cornerback for the Buffalo Bills, number 99. Rookie Jalen Johnson for the Chicago Bears, numbered to just 75. Joey, don't ask me any questions at the NFL rookie premiere. Bosa, numbered to 199, jumbo jersey swatch. How about New Orleans Saints Zach Bond rookie auto number to 199?
I have no idea, but that's what makes collecting.
Golden gloves. How about Hall of Fame legend Ozzie Newsome number to just 25? Boom! Beautiful.
Like that, with the inscription.
How about a Whoa, golden pairs. Davante Adams, Aaron Rodgers, dual patch, number to 199. And for Ivan, well, not really, we have a Cam Akers NFL patch auto numbered 101.
Whoa.
Boom, 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 boom.
Whoa. Is that so? That looks like the football one, the football leather one that they were doing, right?
No. Nope. Is that not the leather?
It is not? Which product had that? Let me go back to the sell sheet.
Look at that. Beautiful. Cam Akers, one of one. Wow. All right, we're going to give that
one away, that's not a gold. That's not a gold shield signature? Hunt for these ultra-rare cards featuring a massive gold NFL shield from an actual football.
That doesn't feel like leather to me at all.
Okay. Yeah. Well, is it leather, though, or do they put a gold thing on the football?
Well, they still have to cut it off. I mean, they'd still... It's a leather piece.
Never mind. I'm looking at the sell sheet now, and the gold shield signatures do look different, but still.
All right, so we're going to give that card away. We're going to give the dual green pay away. We're going to give the golden gloves auto away. And you know what? The other ones will end up in prize packs. So three winners from that. But again, courtesy of Ultra Pro.
Did you
everyone
say
everyone gets one of those? The BCW chain or keychain cutter and supply gauge, card thickness point gauge. What did I say?
Huh? Did you say the Aaron Rodgers duel?
Yeah.
Or the rookie auto guy that no one knows who he is?
The Aaron Rodgers.
Got it.
Ozzie Newsome.
Yep.
Cam Akers. Yeah,
pretty sweet.
That's a sweet jersey card, number 199. It feels like jersey material on Rodgers' side, and then this is definitely a two-color patch for Adams on the other side.
Awesome. So remember, go to GoGTS Live on Twitter. In order to enter to win, I'm working on the tweet right now, but make sure you click follow while you're there. Tweet us some responses to the poll question. And then we're going to dive into this box of Chronicles in just a minute. As soon as I get this tweet up, what are we looking for in a box of Chronicles?
Two autographs. So six packs per box, eight cards per pack.
Yep. And I like Chronicles, some of, course, spans a number of brands.
Yeah, I like some of the feedback I'm hearing and seeing on social for BCW on that sweet modular system. Cool.
Awesome. So, yeah, so make sure you swing over real quick to twitter.com/GoGTSLive. Tweet that out. And let me just tweet out that we're opening this gold, this Chronicles box now.
Yeah, well, just to kill a few more seconds, just a reminder, two lucky winners tonight win Mickie James autographed photos. She wasn't shy in the one she sent either, so lucky you guys. All right, are you ready?
Yep, I'm ready to go. So, yeah, so make sure you retweet the poll question. Make sure you retweet the BCW tweet. Make sure you retweet the Panini Gold Standard tweet, and wow, be ready for whatever we pull from this box of Chronicles basketball. That's, can you find this for under $1,000 now?
I think I saw it at Dave and Adams for $999.
Oh, okay. There you go.
So yes,
depending on what state you're purchasing from. Not in my state, but in your state, it might be under $1,000.
Cam Reddish. Ja Morant on the Luminance design. Zion Williamson on the Threads design.
Ooh,
wow, Zion Williamson. Numbered to just 49, black box.
Whoa. Keep that there for a minute because I was doing the other Zion, the much less crazy Zion. Wow. Okay, I saw it. I got a picture of it. Oh my goodness. So if you're watching right now, actually put that back up there. If you're watching right now, take a screenshot or tweet out the link to your friends and let them know that they need to be in here watching the rest of this rip in order to see if they can have a chance to win that. Oh my goodness.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to pause here and
Put that in a black bordered one touch yesterday.
Well, I'd have to get up to do that. So I'm just gonna top load it for now.
Yeah, just the job base. James just jumped in and said that in the chat, y'all are telling him that it's over $100 for just that job base card.
Well, I better give that away too.
That Zion, that is. Rob, you will not believe what the prices are, the listing prices on it.
All right, hold on. I do have to get up. This is nuts. I'm gonna get the right supplies for the right product, right?
Allegedly has. Well, no, I don't know. You might just want to leave that in a top sleeve. You put it in a penny sleeve already. I wouldn't touch it ever again. I would call up a surgeon, have them pick it up off your desk, put it in a top loader. I'm literally going to Terapeak to confirm that this one actually sold. Because only one is sold. Okay, so it doesn't actually show on Terapeak as sold. So I don't. Maybe that's the only ones listed. Two of them are listed for more than $5,000.
What, this black card we just pulled?
Yes, ink and paper.
Holy cow! Okay.
An ink and paper asset.
I busted out the Ultra Pro.
I'm telling you, don't pull it out of a penny sleeve. Just leave it as it is.
Okay.
Don't touch it. Don't touch it. In fact, for the first time in our show, we're not giving it away. We are going to auction it off for shipping.
You don't even want it in the one touch.
No, I don't want you to touch it ever. Did you just pull it out of the sleeve?
No, I didn't.
Oh, okay. What am I watching on the video then? Okay, I saw something.
I took it out of the top loader.
Yeah. No, don't touch it. Do not touch this card.
Fair enough. All right, well, we'll save the one touches. Hold on one second.
Alex Kent says, what if I win, can I drive to come pick it up? Sure. Ryan is like, sure. I'm in Columbus. Can I do it? Alex just in all caps, listen to Ivan.
All right, so I put the Cam Akers 1-of-1 in the black border one touch instead.
This is like watching an episode. I mean, both of us, but it's like watching a scene from one of those 80s comedies with two guys that have no clue what they're doing.
All right, so just like, I've got the Ultra Pro gold.
I don't think we touch it.
Rookie top loaders and card sleeves.
It's a baby.
And I will carefully put the Ja Morant and the other. Really? Am I saying that? The other Zion?
Yeah. Yeah, what was the other Zion? The Zion Threads?
Yeah.
So the other Zion. So here we are talking about sports card box prices being ridiculous, right? Oh, it's ridiculous. I mean, we... $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 maybe on that card. So let me go back to it. I want to go back to the eBay listings.
Right, there's the
Zion
shot.
Black box out of 49. Yeah, so there's one. It's a purple parallel. What number is yours, by the way? Yeah, card ball. 21. Abbott and Costello's routine. Don't stop touching. Don't touch. Stop touching. Don't touch. Stop touching.
Shut up. You want me to ship these to you guys or what?
No, they're not mocking you. They're mocking all, both of them. I'm just as bad at this as you, too. Don't worry. All right.
Like, there are the Ja
never
the Zions in their rookie card holders. I'm not touching
keep that
this
held
one
up.
Anymore.
Oh, wait. That was such a good touch. Picture. That was a good picture. Oh, okay. Hold up the two other rookie cards together. So the jaw card. You know what's great about that jaw card?
No.
Look at the pick. Do you actually remember that moment?
Yes.
So yes. It was like it's such a good pick. If you don't recall, he did not complete that dunk. He missed it. But the moment was so perfect and the photographer caught it so perfectly that it's like, so it's actually a picture slightly of failure, but man, the fact that made it on a card and a slightly harder to pull, I believe, luminance fall a little less frequently in this. And there's the thing about card collecting. We just pulled a who knows how big card, but yet the Ja Morant is also as cool and warrants a conversation. Also,
do you think I could finish this first pack now, Ivan?
I don't know. I do want to let you know, Chef M. Smith does. He's saying Rob knows how to handle cards.
Thank you.
No one's questioning that. It was just I was freaking out, and because of that, I needed you to not do anything. Just to appease me.
All right, let me finish the pack. We have on the XR design, Eric Paschall, rookie. People like him.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes, they do.
How about Brandon Clark on the marquee design?
And I like that this is your second box of this opening. You know to switch it over. Sometimes you can't even tell when it's a parallel or not.
Paul George, Prism.
On the Prism update, I believe. Is that what they were calling it, update?
And we got some color. We got some Luca color coming up. You ready?
What?
Luca Pink. Luca Pink, hometown heroes, number 2.
What?
49. This is out of the same pack. A pink prism, Luka Doncic, number 49.
Panini was sending you Houdini's packs, apparently. What happened? There was a mix-up at the factory. Luca Busta Ferrari already commented, sorry folks, just a promo box. The real box will be ripped next. But that wasn't even on this one. That was on the one of one. We've never had this kind of heat. This is freaking incredible. How many people are watching now across? Wow. Yeah, so remember, you have to be watching live at the end of the show.
I got a better top loader for that. Hold on a second.
Like, we're giving that Zion away, right, Rob?
We're giving the black Zion away, we're giving the Ja away, and we're giving the Zion threads away and this Luka away. We're giving away 4 cards out of the first pack. We have 5 packs left and haven't even hit an auto yet and already have like, what'd you say? Like $5,500 worth of cards right here?
I haven't even had a chance to comp the Luka because I'm just going out and I'm retweeting this from my personal to let people know. This is unreal.
Now, that black Zion, when you were looking for comps, did you find a sold?
So there was... there was a sold comp on eBay, but it did not show up on TerraPeak, the official eBay research tool, which makes me wonder if it's either not been paid yet or if it was not paid. But there is, so there's other, let me search the other Zion, because there's Terrence other parallels.
Davis rated rookie on the Chronicles design, a tall threat from deep, Carl Anthony Towns. Cody Martin, rookie on the Prestige design, numbered to just 49. Andrew Wiggins on the Optic, and this is the traded. How about Naz Reid on the Hometown Heroes design and auto numbered to just 49? Our producer, a big Minnesota fan, just gasped in my ear. Naz Reid, number to 49, rookie. We'll give that away. Tyler Hero, rookie from the Heat.
What the design Elements is
design? I'm sorry, for who? Tyler?
No, that one. Yeah. Yeah, sorry.
Elements. And then we have on the marquee design, a Ja Morant base on the marquee design. So if someone yells and says that's worth $200.
Wait, where?
What?
Huh? Oh, yeah, I know. I'm trying to catch up here. It's all over the place.
Ja Morant on the marquee, just no number and just the base.
Looks like that is a 2050. No, that's pink. Yeah, $20-$30 card.
Wow.
The marquee card. Oh, can we breathe yet?
All these cards that we don't give away will end up in future prize packs. Cam Reddish again on the Prestige design. There's my guy. There's my guy on the Playbook design, Kobe White.
Ooh, that's a cool rookie.
Kendrick Nunn, rookie on the Prestige design. Luka alert. Luka.
Auto?
Black
auto?
Box. No. Just numbered to 249.
So I don't know if this is quite a fair comp, but the red Hometown Heroes Luka sold for $85, and that's numbered to 149. So you got to think that 249, but a black box design is maybe close to that, maybe a little less than that. But you also got to think the number to 49 has got to be at least three times that, right?
Correct. Cameron Johnson, rookie on the marquee design. All right, I need a comp on this next one. We've got a Rue sighting. Huchimara, red marquee parallel, numbered to 149.
All right. This is the absolute best box of this product I have ever seen. And again, we opened a box last week. It was not like this, so. If this is your first time tuning into the show, this is pretty abnormal for us. I am going to say, so the Zion may not be $5,000. It may be three or four.
Oh, is that all?
Have you ever said that? Have you ever experienced that? A number to 99 is listed for two, but none have sold from the number to 99. There is one at auction from the number to 99, though, so you can begin to watch that. I do not know what it starts.
Here is a Naz Reid rated rookie number to 49 that I'm going to pair up with that Naz Reid auto. You will instantly start a Naz Reid collection if you win. Cameron Johnson rookie, Hometown Heroes. That's followed by a Hometown Heroes Prism of Kobe White. We have a marquee base of Giannis. And close that pack out with Carson Edwards, rookie on the Elements design.
So surprisingly, or maybe it's not surprising, but the Rui Huchimara Hometown Heroes Red has sold for about $12.
Giannis on the Luminance design? Kawhi Leonard. Damian Lillard on the Chronicles to design, never shying away from a challenge. RJ Barrett for you Knicks fans on the Threads design, numbered to 149. Jackson Hayes of the Pelicans on the Crusades design. Doing a little recon with RJ Barrett. Nasir Little gets the Elements treatment. And our second auto is also on the Hometown Heroes design. Somebody's gotta help me. Mufondo Kegabengle of the Los Angeles Clippers. Rookie. Give that away. Mifiondo. I don't know. Sorry. And our last pack. Jarrett Culver. Coby White on the Luminance design. Cameron Johnson, Prestige. Trey Young, Chronicles. Cameron Johnson on the Flux design. Another Crusade, this one of Luka Doncic. Just a regular base version, though. Kendrick Nunn. And on the Vancard design, Luka Samanek for the Spurs. So to review the cards, we'll be giving away our both autos. The Luka Pink, the Zion Panini Threads, the Ja Luminance, and the big hit from that box, the black box Zion Purple Parallel numbered 49.
What number is it again?
21.
Wow. So six cards, right? I just wrote that down, right?
Let's see.
I typed it right.
2, 3, 4.
Don't touch that one.
6, correct.
Oh, man. I haven't had a heart attack like that in a while. So the tweet is already up. Twitter.com/GoGTSLive. If you want a chance to win what I can confidently say is a multiple thousands dollar card. It may not be the five that it's listed for on eBay, but it's got to be somewhere up there. I mean, go to follow us, twitter.com/GoGTSLive, and retweet the tweet that has the link to the show and says retweet and follow, or retweet and watch to enter to win. Again, must be following on Twitter as well, otherwise the system won't draw your name. But go do that now, and then stick around. You have to be watching at the end of the show in order to claim your prize.
And just one quick reminder, every winner tonight of a card also gets a card thickness point gauge and cutter courtesy of BCW. So thanks again, BCW. All right, let's hit that poll question, updating our GoGTS Live Q of the Week poll. Is there a solution to retail hoarding? What would be the best solution? Still have 20 minutes left to vote. This thing nearly doubled since we started broadcasting, up to 315 votes. Now, however, the seeding has not changed. Locked like video games at 44.4%. Limits at checkout 32.7. Very restocking days 15.6. Other 7.3. If you were listening to our conversation about that, I would have voted other based on some of the things that Ivan and I talked about. And that would be manufacturers changing the packout configuration and increasing the price. All right. Well, we've already had a heck of a show, and we've got a lot more great show for you left. Okay, so this week, actually this past week, I was going to fit it in last week, but we were already jammed. I'm a huge open wheel racing fan, so I like IndyCar and love Formula One. And there hasn't been a real Formula One set, you know, in the modern era with all the bells and whistles. The last one was long time ago, you know, base cards, nothing fancy. Well, now Topps has secured a license with Formula One, and I think they paired it with the brand to use. Just take a look at this Lewis Hamilton card. They're going with the Dynasty design. One card per box, hatch auto, number to 10 or less. They have secured the rights to every driver, like Max Verstappen for Red Bull, and everybody else. Not only the drivers, they've also secured all of the team principals. There's Charles Leclerc for Ferrari. How cool is that? I don't know if I want to buy a case of this, a couple boxes, get into breaks of this, pick off singles on the secondary market of my guys, but pretty fancy looking stuff. And so congratulations to Topps. This should be absolutely huge worldwide in Europe and Asia. Look at that. Some dual cards, teammates from Red Bull, including Albon and Verstappen. So really well done. All stuff on card. Every card a patch auto number to 10 or less. Unbelievable.
Yeah, I just love it because I literally I have a friend who works in F1, and he told me just about 6 weeks ago. He's like, hey, you know, start watching this. It's start paying attention. It's going to really grow in the next couple of years. They're poised for some really cool stuff. And so I started. And you know, full disclosure, I bought a Niki Lauda or two and an Anton Senna, Ayrton Senna. Yeah, Senna or two myself. But I'm pretty excited to see what this product does and the conversation it generates.
Well, and if you're at all into F1 now, you have to start watching Drive to Survive on Netflix. It's absolutely thrilling. It's one of the best documentaries in sports, period. So yeah, check that out. Okay. So normally we don't do product previews like that, but man, it's been a long time since open wheeled racing had a trading card product. The last one was IRL by Rittenhouse in, I think, 2007. So
wow. We
will now dive into a look at next week's new releases in a segment we like to call Hot in the Shop. And we kick things off with the NFL Gridiron 2020 Panini Certified NFL Football Card. It's going to deliver you a, number one, a freshman fabric signature card. Number two, an additional autograph card. Three and four hits are two memorabilia cards, plus two rookies or rookie parallels, and three numbered parallels in every box. So let's get this straight. Your box break guarantees a freshman fabric signature, two additional autos, two memorabilia cards, two rookies or rookie parallels, and three numbered parallels in every box. Those freshman fabric signature cards, Chase rookie patch autographs of the top rookies of the 2020 NFL draft class, featuring jumbo jersey swatches, and also look for one-on-one NFL shields, team logos, and nameplates. Some of the additional autograph cards, fabric of the game signatures, oversized patch autos, lasting impressions, a brand new set highlighting the players that have left their mark on the NFL, mirror signatures with a deep 100 card checklist. This autograph set will have a player desire to collect for everyone. New in memorabilia cards is hunt for new inserts, including scoring machines, majestic rookies, majestic stars, stat smashers, which is a brand new SSP insert, and highlights the best to ever play the game. This releases next week. It'll be in stores and at your local, in your local hobby shop, online retailer, and of course, all your favorite breakers. Check it out.
I'm super excited for this next one, especially on the heels of what we were just talking about. More product, more shelves. This week, 2020 Topps Archives Baseball comes into hobby shops, delivering two autographed cards plus one Topps nickname mini poster. Remember, this is the nostalgia set of the baseball card calendar, bringing back popular designs from the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s. This year's set focuses on 1955, 1974, and 2002 for the base set across a variety of parallels as well as rare variations. Obviously, the checklist is packed full of both great rookies, popular veterans and rising stars, and some Hall of Famers and greats to play the game. One of the cool, fun variations in this, in anticipation of the originally scheduled game in Iowa at the Field of Dreams, there are 1989 Topps Cornfield variation cards. So unfortunately that game was delayed, canceled, postponed, but very cool to see it still make its way onto cardboard. Look for things like the base card red parallels on the 1974 Topps. Look for 1955 Topps designs. And then, of course, there are also some other cool inserts like nickname poster cards, 1990 Topps rookies with the 2020 season rookies on the 1990 Topps design, and parallels galore. Hopefully you'll be able to find some of this and rip it with your kids, with your friends. Share the hits on Twitter. Looking forward to Topps Archives again this year.
All right, next up, 2020 Panini NFL 5 Trading Card Game Boosters. Building on the success of last year's NFL Trading Card Game, Panini releases a new booster configuration with six foil parallels, plus four epics, one legendary, and one rookie in every box. 24 packs in a box, 10 cards per pack. Plays in conjunction with the 2019 demo and starter deck, so you can continue to build your team. Collect and play with seven new player cards per team, including rookies like Joe Burrow, Jerry Judy, Tua, and many more. Introducing new power-up cards that supercharge your players while on the field. Build a full lineup from your favorite franchise or mix and match to make your dream team. Nine playable cards and one rules card per pack. Again, fully compatible with the 2019 NFL 5 TCG sets.
Also this week, we have 2020 Leaf Best of Multisport Premium Edition. This Premium Edition buyback product is going to feature four cards per box. Notice the configuration is box purchase only. You're going to chase the redemption card, which is good for a four-box sealed case of 2019-2020 Panini National Treasures NBA basketball cards.
What?
Yeah, so one, you're going to get a redemption, worst redemption you ever got. It's for a sealed case that I'm sure is in Leaf's possession. That's usually how they do redemptions. But hey, that's not all. Here's the question. Would you rather have that case or would you rather have a 1952 Topps Mickey Mantle card, a 2000 playoff contenders Tom Brady autograph, a 1986-87 Fleer Michael Jordan in a PSA 8, a 1993 Upper Deck SP Derek Jeter BGS 9.5. Like, I haven't even mentioned the Mike Trout rookie that's right there on the sell sheet, and plenty, plenty more in this product. Very crazy looking product, huge chase product. Look for that in hobby shops and with breakers this week.
All right, next up, we hit the ice with the NHL playoffs in full swing. We've got 2019-20 Upper Deck Ultimate Collection NHL hockey cards. One of the premium releases of the year. You're going to find one autographed rookie card or one autographed memorabilia rookie card plus two additional autographed memorabilia or autographed memorabilia cards, and one base parallel or ultimate introduction cards in every box. So one pack, four big hits, and the 90 card ultimate introductions insert set boasts all of the top rookies in the game today. Impressive slate of low numbered parallels, as well as the gold auto parallel featuring hard signed autographs, falling on average one in every four packs. Very cool. Ultimate access, more dazzling imagery and hard signed autos, and the gold patch parallel numbered to just six. Ultimate rookies are true rookie cards featuring the top players from the 2019 class. Keep an eye out for ultimate rookie autograph cards numbered as low as 99. Ultimate rookie auto patch cards number as low as 49, and hobby exclusive one-of-a-kind one-of-ones. Ultimate rookie auto shield patch cards and the NHL shield patch cards. All autographs are hard signed. Of course they are. A lot more to look for in this product. Be sure to check out the full details on GoGTS.net.
And a very fun product coming from Topps for the entertainment world this week. 2020 Topps Star Wars Authentics 8x10 blind packs. So here's what's cool about Topps also doing memorabilia like this. You can get a blind pack where you're going to be able to pull an autograph from one of the top signers from the Star Wars universe on an 8x10, and know that it's authentic because it's coming to you from Star Wars Authentics. Each one is exclusively sequentially numbered, each one includes not only an 8x10, but it also includes an exclusive sequentially numbered Star Wars Authentics trading card along with the photograph, and the return of signers from the Rise of Skywalker and the Mandalorian. So if you've been waiting to get some of those Mandalorian autographs, signers from the Mandalorian include Giancarlo Esposito, Gina Carano, Nick Nolte, Werner Herzog, and Omid Abtai. There are also some standalone film signers such as Felicity Jones, Alden Ehrenreich, Forrest Whitaker, Riz Ahmed, Donnie Yen, and there are some classic and prequel signers including Harrison Ford, as well as Hayden Christensen. Well, you know how I feel. And the new trilogy signers, Daisy Ridley, Adam Driver, Domhnall Gleeson, Billy Dee Williams. List goes on and on and on. Looking very, very cool from Star Wars Authentics. 8x10 blind packs in hobby shops this next week.
And that's a look at Hot in the Shop. New releases popping next week in your local hobby shop, favorite online retailer, or breaker. All right, by my count, we have 16 prizes to give away tonight. That Ivan is going to be put to work right now. But as mentioned earlier, Yahoo Finance talked to Rally Road co-founder Rob Petrozzo this week in an interview. He's not only the co-founder, but the chief product officer. And he talks about Rally, fractional shares, this upcoming Topps offering, and more in this interview. Check this out, and we will be back to announce the winners.
Thank you for having me. That's a perfect way to put it. So what we've done is that we have these 10 boxes of Topps 2020 First Edition Complete Sets. It's essentially their flagship product. It's foil stamped. It's the only place it exists. And what we've done is our platform really turns any of these really unique one-of-one tangible assets into stock. So you can buy and sell very similar to the way you buy and sell any equity. It runs through SEC process for qualification. And we take something like this, which has a $100,000 value. We break it into 10,000 shares, and they're available in almost like a mini IPO on our platform at $10 a share for any investor who qualifies.
Love the idea, but who? How do you know the $100,000 value? And especially in a year where baseball is in such all major sports in such disarray, how does that value maintain?
Yeah, so it's an interesting dynamic right now inside the collectible space as a whole. What we've seen is that there's very similar to sort of with equities or with commodities. There's this flight to best quality and to rarest and one of one. I think that, you know, what we've seen in this space is that the stars drive a lot of what's happening, whether that's on the field, off the field, whether it's part of the bigger conversation. But with baseball back and with a lot of attention on the sport, seeing where the future is going to hold for it, seeing some of these stars really start to have breakout seasons and starting to think about what the rookie class is going to be for the future, I think we have a lot of really educated investors who love sports. They love collecting, and they're willing to put their money sort of where their mouth is when they say this person is going to be a star in 4 years or 5 years, or the career of this star right now is only going to grow. I think we've seen that in the entire collecting space, particularly on Rally, when we have these one of one items that we really have to price based on what the market says it should be worth. But that's part of why we do the initial offerings, part of why we have trading on our platform as well, so that the market can truly set the price and dictate whether or not we're correct now and correct in the future.
Rob, Dan Roberts here. I know we're talking about baseball cards, but you guys got started with doing fractional shares in classic cards, originally called Rally Road. And I'm just curious, in terms of kind of the functional aspect of once you invest in a fractional share, something like a car or a baseball card, do you find that some people want to be able to see the item sometimes or display the item in their home for a while if it's a card? I mean, maybe a lot of the buyers here, you know, it's strictly as an investment. But if I were going to buy a share of a classic card, I'd like to be able to hang it in my home for a period of the year. How do people deal with that? Do people have to get in touch with each other when it's, you know, six different investors own a stake in one thing? And then how are the decisions made if someone says, OK, I think this asset has accrued in value and I'd like to sell my piece. But, you know, how do those discussions happen if, say, let's see if we can sell the whole car to someone?
Yeah, good question. And it's been a while since we've seen each other. I really like the playoff beard you have right now. It's very on brand for the baseball season, so I got to give you credit for that. But the way that we think about sort of the future of this space and the way we think about where this platform can go, that's kind of always an option. And we've always thought about sort of that on loan. We've thought about working with museums. We started to have those conversations now. We have a retail space here in New York in Soho, which as soon as the city reopens, we'll be welcoming visitors again to come by and see their investments and be a part of that IPO from the ground floor. But the way we've always looked at this is that we want to sort of work with, A, you know, the best suppliers and companies like Topps. We want to work with best quality assets, which in this case is, you know, 10 cards that for each individual player that only exists here. We want to do things that complement collecting. So when it comes to owning a full piece, whether that's classic cars where we started, whether it's watches, vintage handbags, luxury, some of the things that we're building out, we want to treat these pieces as the museum quality investments, but we always want to give access to our investors. We're always doing sort of merch and sort of meetups and sort of digital events around these items. We always encourage buying the full item. If you can afford it, if you have the means to store and maintain it correctly, absolutely. We look at this as a complement to that, where if you want to invest in, you know, a Honus Wagner card, for example, that's a $600,000 or $700,000 card on our platform. I would love to own that personally as well. But the next best thing and a way to sort of have exposure to that card, that real one of one, is to do it through Rally and then build your collection with the cards that you really love that are more affordable at a price point that makes sense.
Hey, Rob, to talk about the baseball cards in particular, how is this season affecting demand for these cards? In other words, you got an unusual season, let's say that, to say the least, where you have abbreviated season, you have, you know, starting and stopping as we get coronavirus cases. Does that diminish the appeal around these?
Interestingly enough, at least what we've seen in the space, and this goes for all sports, I think, and especially for collecting, is that it's increased the demand and increased the need for the new investor or the collector to become educated on individual athletes and on the space as a whole. So what we've seen is that nostalgia has really sort of taken over, and that's a lot of what this platform is built on. And you have the stars that are always going to be in the spotlight, the LeBron James and the Mike Trout. So we're always going to have that appeal, whether there's a season or not, because they're looking at collectors looking at full career. But what we've also seen is that people are sort of starting to put together their own sort of education and their own timelines for individual players who they see a lot of potential for the future. And these are, you know, these are rookies. These are people who are having breakout games. They're individuals who have a small fan base. But because of the way information travels now, if somebody goes out and hits for a cycle today and it's a name that no one's ever heard of before, we're seeing their cards and their memorabilia and collectibles really pop the next day on eBay and some of the marketplaces that exist as peer-to-peer right now. And we're always trying to sort of be part of that education cycle and be part of that cycle of really understanding where this game is going, whether the game's actually being played or whether we're thinking about later this season or next season, and really get ahead of some of these trends before they come to the forefront. But we're seeing a lot of like really, really educated, even 12, 13, 14 year olds really understand this game and understand what the potential appreciation is for their favorite players who might be a little bit under the radar right now and might not be getting as much face time on TV as they would have if it was last season or potentially next season.
Rob, what do you do about baseball's popularity, right? We all know that it's been falling from its highs. Football is there. Basketball is continuing to do well, and the stars aren't really marketed well in baseball versus the competing sports. I mean, Mike Trout is one of the, you know, a once in a lifetime player, but he doesn't get as much attention as someone like a LeBron James. How do you kind of square that with the pricing for these kinds of commodities?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think that the way that we see sort of baseball in particular is that, and Topps has done a great job of this as well, is that there's a new generation who really values the tangible piece of this game. And whether that's the baseball cards or it's the collectibles that go with it or it's some of the digital things that are being done, Topps it with and probably 20 generations to appreciate the tangible pieces that come with it. Whether that's bringing up, whether it's companies like ours and bringing that to a new generation of collector who maybe thinks about this just as much as a financial instrument as they do of collecting the actual tangible piece of the game as a whole, and try and get ahead of that in a way that, you know, baseball doesn't necessarily live in the same sort of television world as basketball. It doesn't have the same sort of 5-on-5 action and gameplay that goes with it. But I think that what the MLB is doing in really making an initiative to go digital in a lot of different ways right now, and the way that the collectible space is kind of followed with baseball, is going to help sort of pivot a lot of what they've been doing with someone my generation, the 37-year-old who, you know, loved baseball as a kid and collected cards. I'm now getting back into it, as a lot of my friends are, and this 12 and 13-year-old getting back into the collecting space as sort of their entry back into baseball, into following their players and getting into fantasy and doing the things that football and the NBA for the last decade have done really successfully. I think the MLB is starting to do a lot more, and the companies around them are doing a lot more to push that narrative with that younger generation.
Right. Product, Rob, thank you so much. Good to see Rob Pedroza is Rally co-founder and chief product officer.
All right, we are back. Pretty interesting interview, right? Real intelligent, likable guy. So good luck to him. We'll see what happens with those 10 Topps 2020 first edition factory sets. All right. Excuse me, Ivan. I got 16 winners.
Yes, you do. Sorry, I don't know why I'm getting feedback. Nothing's going on. Can you hear me clear?
Yeah.
Check. 1, 2, 3. Am I bouncing? Okay, because I've got a lot of information to give to people. If you're watching the show, you want to listen, because now is the time. We've got 16 winners, as Rob stated. Starting off with swag packs, Mickey James autos, some BCW awesome card sorting trays, the gold standard hits, the Chronicles hits, and that incredible black box Zion numbered to 49 from Chronicles. So that being said, if you're tuning in for the first time or the 100th time, heck, we've done even more episodes than just 100, I believe. You need to know how to claim your prize. You have to have been watching, you have to have followed us on Twitter, and you have to have retweeted the tweets that applied. And the winner was drawn from those. If you hear your Twitter name called, you are going to have to email us, gogtslive@gogts.net. Name of the show, gogtslive, at the website, gogts.net. Email us your name, your Twitter handle, your mailing address. It's not magic. We do have to know that in order to get it to you. And what you won to help us align things easily. And the fifth, just do that. All right. So we're going to start off. Obviously, we're going to save the black box Zion for the very last one. So stick around. But first off, two lucky winners of Go GTS Live swag packs, which are also going to get some extra BCW tools of the hobby, so to speak. The first one is at Melincheck. Congratulations at Melincheck. Sad to not see you at the National, but happy to see that you're still watching the show. The second one is BN9700. I love what Pitbull 0422 just said in chat, which is, I need that Acres. I like your vision. Who cares about the Zion? Give me the Acres 101. That said, we're not there yet. First, next up, we've got a couple of Mickey James autographs. Thank you again to Mickey James for the great interview she did for us a few weeks back and then for sending these after the fact. You can find those on YouTube. Go GTS Live, Mickey James. The winners are the Sandlot Gang. Congratulations, Sandlot Gang. And MovieFan91. MovieFan91. Send those to us. Next up, from BCW, we've got two different boxes of two of their sorting trays, as well as a whole bunch of other fun goodies, the box cutters and the thickness gauges. Those are going to DPW333. DPW333. Next up is at Methodical794. At Methodical794. So congratulations, both of you. And then the Walker Buehler rookie clearly authentic autograph, which came from BCW as well, is going to at VileSWK. At VileSWK. Congratulations. All right, a little football action. Actually, some big football action. A Hall of Famer and then a rookie one of one with some other guys for that green team up north sprinkled in there. Let's start there with the Aaron Rodgers dual relic. That's going to Scott Markman. Congratulations, Scott Markman. Then the Ozzie Newsome autograph is going to at 859BSM. At 859BSM. Congratulations on that Ozzie Newsome Hall of Fame autograph from Gold Standard. And then the Cam Akers one of one is going to M. Balsley. I thought there was going to be a number. M. Balsley. M-B-A-L-S-L-E-Y. You won the Cam Akers one of one. Congratulations. And now from Chronicles, the Naz Reid autograph is going to at PVW1018. PVW1018. Congratulations on the Naz Reid autograph. The Mifundu Kabingla autograph. I apologize to you, sir, wherever you are, for butchering your name. But that autograph is going to Panda Bear Bechtel. Congratulations, Panda Bear Bechtel. The Luca Pink Hometown Heroes is going to New York Loves D-Dub. Congratulations, Claudia. New York Loves D-Dub. Next up, the Zion Threads goes to Nick Ravel 317. Nick Ravel 317. We're getting there. That's the Zion Threads. Next up is the Ja Luminance. Love this card. That's going to at Waxtopia. Oh, it's coming down to it. I see the suspense building. The drum roll is in my head. The black box, Zion Williamson, number 21 out of 49, is going to KRSP70. KRSP70. Congratulations, KRSP70. I do like seeing all of the winners that are excited there in the chat, too. It's fun seeing Waxtopia's response, Matt Balsley, so on and so forth. But the big winner, KRSP70, congratulations on winning the Black Box Zion. So, again, all winners need to email us, gogtslive@gogts.net, with your name, your mailing address, what you won, and your Twitter handle. And we'll get those prizes out. Hey, just a reminder too, we ship those prizes, cost us a little money. If you're watching via Twitch and you're with Amazon Prime, you can subscribe for free with your Amazon Prime account. And that gives us $2 a month. So it offsets half of a shipping cost for one item. But it helps, every bit helps. So we really definitely appreciate that. So
it all adds up.
If you're watching on Twitch and you have the ability, hit that sub button. You can do it for free with Amazon, or, you know, if you like us and want to sub. Hey, SW Vile just subbed. Thank you so much. I'm guessing that you might be the other. It was spelled the other way, but Keb62980 wants to know, how can I get a keychain cutter? Well, I think that you've got more than you're sending out this week, right, Rob? So maybe watch again next week and we might give some away with next week's prizes.
Yeah, why not?
So,
all right. So here's the deal. One other thing we want you to do. Ivan does such a great job of that. One more thing. Hey, go download our brand new app at the Android store on Google Play. And don't worry, iPhone users. It's much more complicated to launch an Apple app, and we're in the process of that. But go download that app on Google Play. Let's see. No programming notes. Special thanks to Mickey James for following through on her promise to send us some autograph photos. Special thanks to Ted and Ken over at BCW. That was a really special opportunity. Yeah, I thought it was neat just reading about it when I got the solicitation material. I didn't think I was actually going to be able to get my hands on it, let alone be able to get some into your hands. So that's really cool. Sure to thank them on social. James Gale behind the scenes, always doing a great job. Ivan, what a pro you are, dude. But I think that's going to do it for now. We will be back next week with a brand new episode of Go GTS Live, the Hobbies web show. So for Ivan and James, I'm Rob Bertrand. We'll see you next week. Have a great weekend. And you know what to be doing. Always be collecting. We'll talk to you soon. Take care.